You've tuned into InvisiYouth Chat Sessions, a video podcast series. Our episode starts right now. Here's your host, Dominique Vale.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the InvisiYouth Chat Sessions, where you can check in for your dose of stigma-breaking, humor-filling, motivation-loving, life hacks, and empowerment tips for all of the medically adultish people in your life. I'm Dominique, the founder of InvisiYouth and host of InvisiYouth Chat Sessions, and today is the final episode of Season 3B of 2021 and the end of this crazy hybrid of two seasons and multiple virtual programming into one. Starting in 2022, InvisiYouth will be back with our beloved monthly video chat show podcast, with InvisiYouth Chat Sessions being in Season 4, and you will also be getting an additional audio program from us, which will be a Spitfire monthly podcast, which I will be hosting as well, where you will be getting empowered, learning some fun, practical life mindset tools, and you will be having fun all in 20 minutes or less. So be sure to look out for that in 2022. But as we are here in our final episode, it is episode 40, and I am overjoyed about having our special guest on for today, because we are going to be talking about all things bringing us back to nature. We're gonna chat about outdoor adventuring, about the environment and that connection to the chronic illness and disability community, and something that many of us feel like might be out of reach, especially being in the chronic illness space. So I am so excited to say hello to my guest, who is a Canadian environmental scientist and disability outdoor adventuring guru, Kelcie Miller-Anderson. I'm super thrilled because Kelcie lives with different complex chronic illnesses like mitochondrial disease, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, and mast cell activation syndrome. But Kelcie is not allowed the stereotype of illnesses hindering her life framing at all. In fact, she's really fused her passions and her career with the direction that her life has gone with living with chronic illnesses, which I love, similar for myself. She is ethically accredited. I'm just going to name a few because this would be like an hour bio, guys, if I went through it. Kelcie has developed a novel remediation technologies for environmental contamination when she was 15, developed her first company, Micro Remedy, at 21, that provides natural, efficient, and cost-effective remediation for the environment, and has done a life goal of mine. She's given a TED Talk, which if you guys know me, you know I love a TED Talk. Kelcie has learned how to overcome adversity with innovation, and now fuses her love of outdoor adventuring on her platform, The Chronic Explorer, which has some of the coolest videos. Guys, you'll see later in the show, I will probably, if you're on our YouTube, I will be popping up photos of Kelcie's outdoor adventuring, because it's the amazing treks outdoors with mobility aids, you will see. With Kelcie, we're gonna make science fun for everyone, the outdoors amazing, and disability representation awesome. So Kelcie, welcome to the show.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. I'm really thrilled to be chatting, you know, even to just be chatting this year with another, you know, chronically ill entrepreneur and another person who has similar experiences to me. It's so nice to just get to have that conversation. And I'm so glad that others are going to be joining us from home too and get to listen in.
Absolutely. It's going to be so much fun. I'm super excited to get into it. And we're going to jump right in, that everyone will get to know you a bit better and all of our listeners and viewers, with 5-second challenge.
5-second challenge. 5-second challenge.
5-second challenge is our way of getting to know Kelcie, and we will be putting her under the countdown, 5 seconds or less, and Kelcie will be rapid firing some answers on questions so we can all get to know her. So Kelcie, are you ready? We're strapping you in for this.
I'm ready.
All right. What is your favorite word in your science career that you get to use often, like a sciencey word?
I mean, I like mycelium because it's the word for fungi that nobody has ever heard of.
I love that. What is your favorite location that you have traveled to?
I've been through the Northwest Passage, and that's definitely, you know, not a lot of people get to do that.
Oh my God, that's so cool. If you could use 3 words to describe your work in science, what would they be?
I think nature-based innovation.
Oh, You gave me a phrase too. Go for it. I love that. What is your, I said you were Canadian when I did your bio, so where is your favorite place in Canada?
Yeah, so it's definitely where I live. I'm half an hour from the beautiful Rocky Mountains.
Oh, I love that. Oh, beautiful. If you could do any sort of outdoor adventuring activity, what is like on your life to-do list of a kind of activity?
Swim with the whale sharks.
Oh, fun. What is your best season to do outdoor activities versus is it also your favorite season or do you have a personal favorite outside of it?
So I do really like winter, but for me currently, summer is the season when I can really get outside more.
Yeah, I love looking out the winter. My nerve damage, not so fond of the cold.
Exactly. It's cold out.
Oh, my body doesn't agree with my brain.
No.
If I know from a young age you loved science, but if you had any other career direction, what would it be?
It would definitely still be related to the environment, so maybe environmental law.
Oh, I like that. That's cool. You, for people who see you on Instagram, I mentioned it at the top too, you have some of the coolest adaptive equipment on the planet. So this is kind of a question if you might already have one, but do you have a name for any of your adaptive equipment? If you don't, would you, what kind of name would you give it?
I mean, we don't really have a name. We just call it the rig or my big chair. But the rig is what the company calls it, but I think it fits pretty well. So
it does. It does. I like that. It makes it feel like it's this chat. It's
right?
this entity. I love that. Since we're doing this is our episode, obviously if you're watching on YouTube, you can see I am decked for the holidays, as I usually am in my home office. So what is your favorite, do you have a favorite holiday activity that you love to do?
I mean, I just like getting out and enjoying the snow, and I've not been able to do that since I've become a wheelchair user as much, but this year I have my off-road wheelchair, so hopefully I'll be back to lots of holiday walks in the snow.
Oh, I love that. And then what is your favorite part of doing disability activism on social media?
Oh, the community by far. I mean, it's the only place I think where you get to interact with people who actually understand what you're going through and have similar lived experience. So
I love that. That is true. Best community by far. We can attest to that with InvisiYouth as well, for sure.
That's amazing.
And yeah, I mean, going off of that too, before we go into our next segment, kind of segueing out of advocacy through the community, I know what we are going to be sharing with you guys was developed from our community for all of you. So I'm really excited to share it with everyone. So I am going to tell you about a major new InvisiYouth update, which will be fully going into effect in 2022, but we're bringing it a little early with a limited edition for the holiday season. We are bringing our first piece from our merchandise collection that will be all about InvisiYouth's subtle activism style and flair. We have our limited edition handmade bracelets. These are color blocked bracelets. If you're on YouTube, you will see visuals of our bracelets popping up. It is our typical color block. They are made all by chronically ill young adults as well. And our bracelets are super affordable. They're chic. They're very gender neutral friendly as well. And it is a great addition to your collection or the collection of someone you love or in your life. You can do two things with our limited edition bracelets. You can either buy one for yourself. We will have the links popping up underneath me and in our description. Or you can donate and match that donation where we will then give away one of our bracelets to someone else as well. So all throughout the month of December and January, any donations made on our website, that link will also be in the description below. It's invisiyouthcharity.com/donate. Any donation over $5, we will match with giving away one of our limited edition color blocked bracelets. And every 100%, every single cent that goes into anyone who buys our color blocked bracelets will also be donated back into our programming and resources we provide throughout the year. So you can either buy a bracelet or donate a bracelet. Either works. It's super affordable, like I said, and it's in these 2 months with these limited edition bracelets. You will want to be someone who buys one of our first of our merchandise. So like I said, all of those links will be in the description below. And instead of me continuing to chat about how excited I am about all of our subtle activism merchandise, I'm going to chat more with Kelcie in our next segment, Chat Me Up.
Chat me up.
Hey, wanna chat?
Chat Me Up is where we are going to put on our thinking caps and get to chat about a subject that we know Kelcie is passionate about, science and innovations. I'm going to be stepping out of the classroom formula. We're going to be discussing unique approach of really fusing disability and science, especially environmental science and activism together with Kelcie. So I'm excited about this because, guys, as you know, science was something I've always been intrigued with, but never my domain, hence why I run a nonprofit. That is for interpersonal skills and not the environment. But nonetheless, I know science for you is professionally and in your advocacy, it's been such a large part of your life, and you started doing so much at such a young age. So what really drew you to science immediately, even as a kid and a teenager?
Yeah, so I think the love of science started with an early love of sort of nature and the world around me. I was really curious of, you know, what was going on and why do leaves change color and why is this growing there and not here, and asking all of those sorts of questions. And I was introduced to science pretty early because I had an older brother and he had to do science fair projects and things like that. And when I realized that science was this amazing tool that I could use to answer all of these questions I had for myself, I was hooked. And, you know, there was no sort of, I was in love with science from then on. So it definitely started with that early curiosity of kind of the world around me and getting to like explore outside. I think they're so interconnected.
Oh, I love that. No, absolutely. I have an older sister, so I can relate to the things they do definitely spearhead you in a direction of whether they liked it or not, you will find your interests watching them get to do it. Really, definitely. And even kind of going off of that, I know what I had also said before is for environmental science and sustainability, it's something that's brought up even in the media so often now, that it can feel very intimidating for people trying to feel like they're doing enough or what's too small to even be doing. So for you, what are starter ways for people that just want to get more informed or learn about environmental science even in their area?
Yeah, I mean, I think something that's really important is to remember that, you know, climate change, environmental problems, none of that is on you as an individual to fix. All you have to do is the best you can. And, you know, I've seen a lot that the sort of environmental movements and environmental spaces have in the past been kind of very like, almost like stringent and exclusionary in their efforts. You know, if you look at like the plastic straws, banning plastic straws, and there was no flexibility there. And it was all of a sudden, it was anyone who's using a plastic straw is bad, without looking at the nuance of it, that, you know, plastic straws are a medical device for some. Some people need more, you know, single-use plastics to keep things sterile as part of their medical needs. And so we're all different as individuals, and we can all contribute in a different way. And as long, you know, small things do count, but it's up to you as an individual to decide, you know, what you can do that is still like comfortable for you and still allows you to live, you know, a healthy, happy life. You don't need to suffer on sort of behalf of it. You know, what you can do is good enough.
Yeah. No, definitely. And I think even kind of going off of that too, you kind of even touched on it, that these issues of climate change, it's none of these happened overnight as well. So you don't have to be immediately successful in converting everything into more green energy and eco-friendly right away. Like, it can be an evolving, the same way you would adapt for your physical or chronic illness needs. You can sort of take that in slowly, watch a few documentaries, read other articles, like click that tab of interest on your Twitter account that the science page or articles you want to see pop up on your feed. And it's just sort of those smaller, like you said, smaller conscious efforts of what you're capable of, and that will kind of become things that you're more absorbed in.
Oh, exactly. I mean, it's what you can do, you know, whatever your best is enough. And yeah, definitely small actions like becoming informed, whether that's, you know, following activists on Instagram in the space and getting short tidbits to stay up to date on what's happening, and supporting, you know, different sort of environmentalists and movements in your area or online. That is an action in itself and is so important. And so, yeah, I guess the first step, like you said, is just those small things, getting informed, learning, becoming sort of an active participant in those conversations. You don't have to overhaul your life to make a difference.
Oh, yeah, definitely. And even, I know you touched on it too, is noting that intersection of disability and chronic illness with sustainability and environmental science, especially like you touched on with the Plastic Straw movement moving forward. It really was able to look at it on a glass half full way. It really was able to bring the disability community into more of a mainstream lens, because it was so many people across different illnesses and disabilities all asking for the same sort of, adaption, but they were just sort of asking for understanding and less way to meet in the middle. So I think for you, what are ways that you think that the sort of sustainability space can be more accessible? I know you've done work, obviously you've had your own company, you've done so much. So what are things that you've noticed as your health has evolved that you're like, oh, these are different things that make it more accessible for other people?
Yeah, so that's actually kind of what I'm working on now. And I've sort of noticed that there's, you know, sort of three main pillars of things that I think we can do to help. And one of the main things is that there's just sort of no visibility of disability in that space. There's not a lot of representation of disabled voices. So we need to start talking about that and asking why. And, you know, over the past 6 months, I've been doing a lot of research into, you know, environmental organizations, especially youth focused ones. So under 30, who, you know, are working on environmental science and climate science and activism and all of that. And even the ones who have diversity, equity, and inclusion missions and statements, they're not recording data around disability. They're not including it as part of their diversity. And so that's one thing we need to change, is we need people, you know, talking about disability in the space and making sure that it's something that they're focusing on. Even if recording and publishing their metrics around disability, even if those numbers aren't great now, we need to start talking about it, because we need to realize that there's a problem and know sort of where we're starting from. And I think so that problem, that there's not really a lot of, you know, representation of disabled people in the space, kind of stems from two issues. One is obviously that representation. If you don't see people like you when you're growing up, you don't feel like you belong in that space. And then another one is just the access to opportunities for disabled youth, especially when it comes to them getting involved in outdoor activities and nature-based activities. There's just not options for them, whether, you know, it's a lack of funding for outdoor equipment or programs just not willing to be accessible and, you know, prioritize including these youth. If youth don't have the opportunity to fall in love with nature and fall in love with the environment when they're young, how can we expect them to, you know, want to protect something that they don't have a connection with? You know, we can't expect that. So we need to just make more opportunities, I think, in general, in the outdoor spaces for disabled people. And it's all going to go from there. We just need that inclusion, which isn't every industry asking for that.
Exactly. And I think even you touched on it too, is that so many companies, even in the science space, but even in us doing philanthropy. So we're constantly surrounded by chronically ill and disabled young adults, but trying to get in to get even funding, it's mainstream companies that say we want diversity, but the chronic illness and disability space isn't one that they knee-jerk assume is part of diversity. So I always will say you really should try to tell the charities that you want to work with, find the ones you like, note to yourself that you're not represented in them or they're not accessible enough, and then reach out or have someone that's a friend of yours, have that ally friend of yours that isn't a part of the disability space, have them reach out with you or on your behalf and ask about it, because most, not especially from a philanthropic space, if we're told that we could be more diverse, we'll do the action and the work to make sure we can get you involved then, and then hear that voice as well. So really kind of lean into the desire that a lot of places have of finding more diversity, and then lean into that you're a part of that community, like you said. And I think it will open more doors, because a lot of people will then realize that just having someone like you as a volunteer in the space will allow them to see a different perspective, that they can tweak small things that aren't these gigantic accessibility payments that they're assuming they will end up needing to do.
Right. Yeah. People don't understand how simple, like small things that are very inexpensive can make something so much more accessible. And even if you just look at, like, you know, companies who are starting to be a lot more diverse in their advertising and marketing and things like that, well, you know, spend some money, hire disabled models, hire disabled creatives, and just, you know, the visual of having disabled people in your product catalogs or, you know, exploring the outdoors, that helps disabled people see that they are belong and are welcome in those spaces. But beyond that, it also shows everyone else who, you know, is an outdoors person or enjoys hiking, enjoys being outside, that disabled people enjoy the same things. And it's normal that we want to have those same experiences, because I think a lot of them just don't have that interaction with people with disabilities, and they assume that we're not like them. Well, why would a disabled person want to hike? Well, disabled people are just like you. Of course we want to hike and be outdoors. Why do you want to hike and be outdoors? So.
No, definitely. And I really like that you mentioned that too, because it is just, even for someone who is chronically ill or disabled, it feels so, it, like I said, it feels like it's such a large ask from someone to try and get involved in sort of sustainability as well, that I'll even say, if you have more physical capability, like, look into ways that recycling is easier for you, or LED bulbs, things that are sort of smaller, things that are tangible. But if physical activity isn't something you're capable of, like reading legislation and signing those petitions or sharing environmental science marches or meetups that are happening, that's something that you then have access to then sharing as well, or supporting, that doesn't require you to, like you said, exert yourself medically in a way that's going to be too taxing.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, there's so many ways to get involved and even to connect with nature too. You don't actually have to go for a big hike in the mountains or anything like that. Like, you can just get outside, you know, for a walk around your community. If you're not feeling up to that, maybe sit on your doorstep for a few minutes and just enjoy breathing the fresh air, listening to the sounds of birds, those types of things. If you're not up to that, maybe you can watch a nature documentary, read a book about nature, listen to, you know, sounds of the ocean or the rainforest, or those types of things can give you sort of some of those, like, there's actual healing benefits to being in nature, you know, can reduce stress, really, you know, help calm you. And you can get those benefits from doing small things. It doesn't have to be a big hike or a huge adventure every time. The little things matter too.
Oh yeah, definitely. And even kind of to end this segment, I was going to ask, I know a big thing for you is talking about innovation and adaptation and how that really molded from what you were building in your science career with your company with Micro Remedy, and building a lot of the work you were doing in science, and then kind of evolving through that was adapting to what your health was capable of doing. So mm-hmm. I know so many other people are in that situation. Even InvisiYouth 2021 was a big overhaul of all of our programs. We'll be relaunching as well, because my health changes and what our population needs changes too. So what would you say are ways that you found that you were able to still be innovative and do the work you like to do without, like, challenging your health? What are things that have worked well for you?
Yeah, so it's definitely been a huge change. When I did found my company, I was chronically ill, and I knew I was sick. Like, we knew that, but I didn't really have solid answers. I didn't yet have a diagnosis of the Ehlers-Danlos or mast cell. I had been told, you know, it's just complex chronic migraine. That's what's going on. you know, that's why you can't walk. It's kind of crazy. But so, I mean, I went from having my own lab where it was kind of, that's pretty physically taxing, to I took a step back and I said, okay, well, right now I can't be in the field and I can't be in the lab, but there's still a lot of things I can do. And, you know, I can make impact in different ways, whether that's, you know, sort of through advocacy or public speaking to schools. And I actually ended up founding my second company sort of in my downtime, where I was working actually on a different issue. It was sort of agricultural production and protection of pollinators. So how do we help honeybees through technology? So it was using blockchain, and it was sort of a type of science. And a type of tech, a company that I could completely build from my bed. There was no sort of, you know, physical need for me to be in a lab, be in in-person meetings, that type of thing. And I think especially post, you know, the pandemic and how things have transitioned more online, that's even more of an opportunity for disabled innovators, because now it is more normalized that you don't need to be in person, in a physical space. We can work across borders, we can work online. And, you know, people have accepted that you can make just as much impact, you know, working from home. And for us, maybe working from bed. Like, you don't have to be able to get out and do it to make a difference.
Yeah, definitely. And I love, like you mentioned, with the pandemic, it's really given the ally, chronically, non-chronically ill and non-disabled community, a perspective of what adapting looks like. And it's given, for us, it's given us a benefit, because now we kind of have a leg up on the, we have way more than just the 2-year pandemic experience of knowing how to adapt and do virtual work and connect, because you have that experience of having to do it because of medical purpose. So really take what you might see as hindrances on flare up days or bad days and kind of use it to your advantage. And then I know you've talked about this as well quite a bit. It's something I always reiterate, is time management is probably like the best. It is not the sexiest innovative tool on the planet, but nonetheless, it's really when you take the practical time to even just trial and error. For myself, power hours are really great, so that I can take a break after. And even if my break is an additional hour, knowing that I have that concrete hour that I'm pushing my health a little bit, and I know I have a time limit and I'm able to be as successful as I can be. But for other people, it's small increments throughout the 10 hours of a day. It's 10 minutes here, take a break, another 20 minutes here. And it's really kind of finding what works in managing your time. And I think that's probably what I'll always say is, that's where it's really innovative, is figuring out what works for you, what works for, even if you're working at home, what'll work for your boss, what they need in a traditional 8-hour day. What are you able to start earlier and take more breaks throughout the day, or have a longer window of time to get things back? It's really about kind of figuring out that management of that really works well with what is your health and who you are and what you do.
Oh yeah, you're so right there. I know, I mean, disability and chronic illness is actually such an advantage in some ways, because yeah, it does allow you those time management skills. And also, you've been taught to sort of be innovative and be a problem solver in your daily life. You have to do it every day. That's how we survive. And so I think that lends itself so well to being able to adapt and respond and create innovative sort of workarounds and solutions to the problems that we're facing, you know, in work as well, and in time management and all of those things. So yeah, I think it can actually be such an advantage, and we just need to reframe how people are thinking about it, because we know it's an advantage. We live with it. We've experienced it. But yeah, I think these past 2 years, finally other people are starting to see, you know, oh wow, like, they have a lot to teach us. They, you know, are very innovative. They are, you know, good problem solvers, and we're finally getting to showcase that. So I think it's been really good.
Yeah, I would absolutely agree with that. And that even before we kind of hit our middle point in our intermission of the show, talking about the benefits of providing these sort of ideas and even what we'll always say is such common sense life goals and tools is really what InvisiYouth is all about, is providing all of these resources and programs and interactive activism so that wherever you're at in your chronic illness or disability journey, you can utilize our resources and programs and then implement them into where you need them in your daily life so that you can be successful and joyful wherever you're at. And we're able to provide all of these for free because we run through by donations. So I always spend that time of the show thanking everyone who does donate throughout the year, from $1 to multiple zeros at the end of it. Every single one really does impact and counts to providing everything for free. So I always pop our donation link down. It keeps our lights on for our shows and things as well. And every donation really does impact our nonprofit and really help us keep moving forward and supporting so many young people to find avenues of innovation and success like Kelcie has as well. And what I'm excited about, guys, is you know it's intermission segment. You know it's my favorite time of the show. It's where I get to drink my coffee and Kelcie can tell us a life story, guys. It's your favorite. It's So That One Time.
So That One Time.
Are you ready?
Kelcie, you are the first guest who has been eager to tell their story and not panic when I reached for my coffee. So Kelcie, tell us a story.
Okay, I have one that I think should be quite entertaining. It involves a celebrity figure.
Ooh.
So because of my work, I get to travel a lot internationally and I get to go to a lot of really cool events and participate in think tanks and panels and sort of, you know, roundtable discussions. And I was at an event in London, England. This is in October 2019. It was my very first trip in a wheelchair as a wheelchair user, and my first conference, all of that as a wheelchair user, first everything. Actually, the first time I left the house with my new wheelchair was when we went to the airport.
Oh my God.
Yeah, it was pretty crazy because I'd been, you know, sick and in hospital sort of before, and I just didn't have the energy to try it out before we left. But so that had its own struggles, you know, flying as a wheelchair user. We get to London. My mom came with me, thankfully, and we get on the train. And obviously, you need assistance to get on those trains. But they put us on the wrong train. And you need a ramp to get off when you get to your station. And we were so terrified the whole time that there wasn't going to be a ramp. Luckily, that was fine. But we get off sort of in, you know, downtown London. And there just so happened that there was a million person strong Brexit protest that day.
Oh, no.
So sort of my first experience in a wheelchair was in hordes of people. And luckily my mom was with me because all these people was just so overwhelming. I was like, I just want to go home. Like, anyway, we get to the hotel and relax. And my conference started the next day. And as part of this conference, there's a group called the Elders. It's a bunch of sort of more senior world leaders. I think most of them are probably their 70s onwards. So, you know, UN ambassadors, UN high commissioners, things like that. And so, and business leaders. So I was invited as, you know, a group, I think one of the 10 like young environmental leaders, and there was different tables throughout discussing different issues. So we're discussing, you know, how can we make climate and environmental activism, you know, more equitable? How can we push change in this area? And so we have our discussion for sort of half an hour, an hour among our group. The group nominates somebody to then, you know, speak and share our findings and sort of consensus with the other tables who were discussing like the refugee crisis and agriculture and all those types of things. And so I was picked, and my table happened to be the first of the five tables. And so they hand me the microphone and I start speaking. And then from across the room, Richard Branson stands up and he stops and he says, wait, can you please stand up while you're speaking? And the room just kind of went quiet because everybody around me could see that I was a wheelchair user. And obviously when he said it, he didn't know And I was just like, oh, sorry, like, I'm actually going to stay sitting. I'm a wheelchair user. And the poor guy was mortified, obviously. Like, he had no idea because we had been seated at tables. So he couldn't tell that I was using a wheelchair, not just sitting in a chair. So luckily he was very nice and came and apologized and talked with me after, which was really cool because, you know, he's definitely one of my sort of aspirational entrepreneurs. But I think it's cool because if I ever meet him again, I'm sure it's a story and a moment in his life that he won't forget either, you know, asking the wheelchair user to stand up. So.
Oh my God, that is absolutely hysterical. By the way, I could just imagine the people in your table and the like close tables just being like, I don't know, to feel bad for Richard Branson at the moment, or Kelcie and go, oh my God, no. So, oh man.
I mean, I think it's something that like nobody knew how to react. They're like, oh my gosh, I can't believe, like, like mortified. And obviously, like, it wasn't a big deal at all. But it is funny because like people think things like that are a huge deal. It wasn't. And to clarify, I am an ambulatory wheelchair user, so I can stand to some degree, but I would never stand when presenting because I'd probably like fall over or something. But, yeah, so that the clarify that too, that many wheelchair users can stand, but I do think if he had seen I was in a wheelchair, he probably wouldn't have asked.
Oh my gosh, I love that. And even that ties in so perfectly into our next segment as well, because clearly Sir Richard Branson's first few words to you were very interesting, and it's built a nice future potential rapport for the both of you. So we're going to go into our next segment titled the same thing, First Few Words.
First Few Words.
First few words, you know, oftentimes we don't know what to say at first and how to get that ball rolling, especially addressing a topic that we might not know a lot about. And so the first few words we can imagine would be critical in an unfamiliar topic like outdoor adventuring for those with chronic illness and disability, to make it accessible and friendly to others. So we are going to learn how to get outdoorsy with Kelcie, especially for those of us who are like Kelcie and I that are chronically ill. So I know I mentioned that your platform with the Chronic Explorer, you really do share so much about being in the chronic illness space and disability and getting outdoors and how adventuring can really be tangible. So for you, what, as your health kind of evolved and that became more of a forefront part of your daily life, what made you really want to push to continue to adventure outside and find the accessible ways to do it?
Yeah, I mean, for me, it was such an ingrained part of my identity and who I was. I love to hike. I grew up fly fishing. My dad's a fly fishing guide, and he owned a ski business. So I started skiing at 18 months old. I camped every summer, hiked consistently. And when I got ill and I couldn't do those things anymore, I really felt like I lost a part of myself. And it was really hard, you know, for those few years between when I was already ill and I was getting sicker, and I didn't have a lot of mobility, but I didn't yet sort of use any mobility aids. I wish I would have gotten a wheelchair or things like that earlier to help me continue to enjoy the outdoors. But there was kind of a gap where I lost that ability and I lost that connection to the outdoors. And it was really hard for me because I just didn't feel like myself. And so for the first time now, again, that I have the equipment and the tools to get outside, I finally, you know, have that piece of me back. And I feel like I can say, oh yeah, like I love being outdoors and I love hiking. And, you know, I have kind of reclaimed that part of me. But a lot of it I didn't think would ever be possible again. And I think that's just because of my own sort of preconceived ideas I had about disability and what was possible. I mean, even I know I really wanted to try sit skiing. And my dad was in the industry, so obviously he knew sit skiers and things like that. But the only sit skiers I'd ever seen were, you know, like Paralympians. Mm-hmm. And I think people often forget that there's a difference between, you know, disability caused by injury and being healthy, and then disability caused by chronic illness.
Yeah.
So, I mean, Paralympians, they are top level, fit, healthy, you know, so strong. And then there was me, you know, I am very sick and very weak and have a lot of health problems. And so I looked at these 6 years and I thought, I'm never going to be able to do that. Even my dad said, no, you don't have the arm strength. You're not going to be able to do that. And it was sad, but I kind of just admitted that, okay, I've lost that part of me. And luckily, you know, I have some great friends, and one of my best friends actually was volunteering, got started through work with an organization that gets disabled people outdoors. And she talked to them about it, about the sit skiing while she was volunteering one day. And she came back and she said, you know, I think this is something you can do. Like, you don't need to be as strong as you think you are, like, need to be. They take all sorts of disabilities. They can adapt and they can make it work. And so I was a little hesitant. And then actually what really spurred me to do it is both her and her mom took the course to become volunteers for the sit skiing lessons. And so I was able to go take my first lesson with both of them there supporting me. And it was just amazing. Like, that was what I needed. And I realized that pretty much anything you want to do, they can make it accessible, or they can adapt it in a way that you can participate. You just need to find the people who are willing to help. But don't think, like, if there's, you have a dream or your heart set on something, don't let being disabled stop you, because there are resources out there. There are tools, or, you know, there are sort of innovations we can come up with to make those things happen.
Yeah. And I love the two things that you mentioned too, was you kept mentioning it was about participating. And I think a big thing, even for people who know my backstory, I was a competitive athlete who got injured. To try to go back to the sport, such a big part of my identity was the competitive nature of it. So I knew if I went back to the sport, I loved the competitive nature as much as I loved the actual sport of tennis. So to try and go back and try any sort of adaptive level of tennis or wheelchair tennis, I knew the love I had of the competition would be gone. And so that was big for me, was to realize that was such an important element of it. But you kept mentioning participating, which is so great for people to realize that you don't have to go back to different levels you might have had pre-injury or pre your illness becoming more of a daily part of your life, that participating can kind of fuel a different desire inside of you, that it doesn't have to fuel the same things. It doesn't make it lesser than that you weren't learning how to do sit skiing by yourself and you didn't have anyone with you and learning to do it, and having other people around you that would assist the process. You might only go down once or twice instead of it being 3 hours of your day, that those participating is equal to, like, value. And then having proactive allies was my favorite. Seeing and asking people around you, like having your friend and their mom just being proactive to do that training, so you had people that you could then trust around you. I think that really ties into what I was gonna ask as well, is really that it can be so intimidating to do outdoor activity when you're chronically ill or disabled, especially if hiking or camping were not part of your day to day beforehand. And then now you have adaptive equipment, or for myself, like, I have parts of my cardiac condition, and we have similar illnesses as well. So there are things that it would be nice to be close to a paved road at some point in case things start to go south that I can't control. So what for you are those kind of tips for people that want to work past that concern of, oh, I'm so nervous to even try hiking, or who do I even ask? Like, is it too much to ask my family members to do something with me? Like, how do you work past those worries or concerns?
Yeah, and I definitely had huge worries when it came to getting back out, like hiking in the mountains, you know, once I got my off-road chair. And even before then, when I would push the limits of my normal chair, you know, one of the things that really kind of got me, I was like, well, what if I get a flat tire? Or what if my chair breaks? Or what if, you know, all of these what ifs. And then I realized that even an able-bodied hiker faces a lot of what-ifs. They could fall and injure their ankle. Like, any sort of emergency can happen. And, you know, we have search and rescue. We have people who would come in and assist. And for me, it was important to remember that I am just as deserving and worthy to enjoy those outdoor spaces that, you know, if my wheelchair broke down or something happened and I needed assistance, that's no different than if an able-bodied person needs assistance. I shouldn't feel bad about that. And that was something I really needed to come to terms with. Nothing's happened yet. I mean, I have had a flat tire, but luckily it was at my friend's, like, at her cabin, so we had cars and stuff around. But I like to think about the what-ifs, but I don't dwell on them, right? So think about the what-ifs that could happen, and then in your mind think, okay, well, if this happens, this is what I do. And you can kind of be prepared for those what-ifs. So obviously, like, I have to bring all of my medications, emergency things, EpiPens, all of that. But I also bring, like, warmer clothes, and I bring plastic bags and ponchos and stuff like that in case it rains. I usually always bring someone with me. A big part of that is because when I'm going to the mountains, I don't like to drive, and I need somebody to get my mobility aid out of the car. But one thing I've, like, realized in the outdoor community and traveling with a disability is that people are generally very kind and very willing to help when you need them. And you might feel like you're inconveniencing somebody by asking for help, but you're not, you know? They're probably more than willing and happy to help you. So yeah, that's what I would say, is think about those what-ifs, but don't let them stop you. Just let them help you be prepared.
Yeah, I like that. And I think that's a really great, because even I was gonna ask too, like, for people that want, what were kind of sort of the first few things you did outdoors? Because I know for me, the one thing I always, when I went, we went on a family trip to Colorado and we wanted to go walk and hike through national parks. I remembered, I actually think it was me falling upon when I was on InvisiYouth's Instagram, and it was falling on your Instagram, must have popped up on our feed. It was knowing that so many national parks have accessible trails and they're marked, and that's just part of what they do. And I remember feeling weird asking our family friends that they gave kind of the general area they wanted to go to because we had other things to do. And I remember nudging my parents going, do you think we could ask them if we could do one of these couple instead? Because worst case scenario, I just cannot do off-road hiking. My heart will act up. It's too much elevation. I'll need the help. And it was, I remembered seeing it on your end, that kind of little starter point of, so many national parks have that as access, so I was able to still experience going and hiking and doing outdoors, but in a very safe and valuable way. So for you, what are kind of other things that are sort of starter ways of people wanting to kind of try and do outdoor activity?
Yeah, so I will say, if you're in the US, you are very lucky because of the ADA laws, most national parks have some form of accessible trail. And most of them, actually, I think all of the parks that have campgrounds have accessible camping facilities, whether that's yurts or they'll have accessible outhouses or showers, all of that. So if you're in the US, you have a phenomenal opportunity there. It's different in Canada. There's not a lot, even like information-wise, and that's one of the things I'm trying to change is, there's so many trails and places that are accessible and wheelchair users could enjoy, but they don't know about them. Or it's things like accessible parking or the ridiculous barriers they put up to keep out bikes. Like, you know, they don't have this mindset that disabled people also want to use these spaces and are also users of natural spaces. So I think that's starting to change. But my biggest tip, if you want to find some accessible trails in your area to explore, I start out by just doing I go on All Trails. It's just an app. They also have a website. And I just look in the general region I want to go, and I'll look for easy trails. They have an option you can do paved trails. And they also have, they're coming out in some areas with wheelchair trails. But for now, they have stroller or kid-friendly trails. And, you know, it definitely sucks to have to be like, oh, stroller, like, stroller-friendly. But you know what? If a stroller can do it, my wheelchair might be able to do it too. And so that's how I sort of scope out the trails. Then I sort of read the reviews. And then a tip I have is I look at the trail and I put the location into Instagram and I look at the recent photos. And because this is really important in Canada, especially when we get snowy and rainy conditions, is it allows you to look through user photos of the trail so you can get an idea of, you know, is it gravel? Is it muddy? Is there a lot of roots? That type of thing. And then also, you know, has it already snowed there? Like, is it muddy? Those types of things. So that's something I do. And then the other one would be, there's certainly a lot of hiking groups in your area. If you join their Facebook page and you just say, hey, I'm a wheelchair user, I'd love to get outside. Can you suggest any short or relatively smooth trails you think a wheelchair might be able to go on? And, you know, you have to make sure you take the recommendations as just recommendations, because obviously if you're not a wheelchair user, you're not always going to understand what is and isn't accessible, but it can be a great starting point, which then you can, you know, use those other tools to look more into it.
You guys were, if you're on YouTube, you're too busy watching Kelcie so eloquently discuss that. My jaw was open the whole time going, Instagram geolocation. Why have you never freaking thought of that? Oh man, that right there. Guys, that should be an Instagram. You should do a real teaching to view dropping, drag and dropping, looking.
I'll have to. And it's, you know, it's something that a lot of like environmental people are so against geotagging. They're like, oh, it ruins the space and there's too many people. And I'm like, no, I mean, sure, there might be some negatives to it, but it's something that makes it more accessible, you know. Mm-hmm. And just because something is now more accessible to more people who were excluded before doesn't take away that space's value to you, right? Like, it's not only your trail or only your space. Like, sorry, you have to share.
We share the world together as people.
Right.
But even going off of that great tip, we're going to do our final segment where Kelcie and I are going to build a playlist for life for all of you guys. So we're going to jump into What's Your Life Playlist.
What's your life playlist? What's your life playlist?
We're going to go in What's Your Life playlist, create top things that would be for piquing your curiosity and getting into outdoor adventure, environmental science, and all of those fusing with the chronic illness and disability space. So my first sort of burning question to ask for it is, I know a big thing you talk about even through the Chronic Explorer is doing outdoorsman adventuring. It can be expensive. Even I know you talk, when you mentioned your name for the rig, it's not a cheap piece of equipment to have as well. So what would be sort of the things that you would say for those either looking on a budget, or what would you be Googling to find nonprofits or businesses that would let you rent it for a lower cost or buy it? What are those options for people that say purchasing it might not be in the cards for me?
Yeah, and totally. I mean, you don't need to purchase, especially if you're going to be an occasional user. You don't need to have an expensive piece of equipment sitting in your garage. And so there's a lot of different organizations, and this is going to depend on where you live, but that have the adaptive equipment, have the resources, and even have, you know, coaches and staff to teach you how to use these resources or go on hikes with you, plan those types of things. And so what I would do is, you know, sort of do a few Google searches, do adaptive outdoors or adaptive biking, adaptive hiking, plus your location or wherever you want to go. Another good option is if you're going to a new area, you can maybe join a disability Facebook group from that area or forum and ask there, because those people who live in that area might know the resources that are available. And so I know I had, as I started to get disabled, I had no idea that these types of things were available. And like I said, I wouldn't have known until my friend volunteered, and she volunteered through work, and they did a hike where they take a trail rider, which is, it almost kind of looks like a wheelbarrow, and they can take disabled people, mobility impaired people on pretty much any hike. These things are insane. So she volunteered doing that, and she said, hey, like they have this equipment. And then it turned out they had sit ski lessons. They had all of that. And so it's just, you know, Googling really to start and asking the community, because those resources are out there and they're definitely underutilized for the most part.
Oh, absolutely. And like you said, even when you mentioned like all trails, like searching through app stores is phenomenal, because a lot of, I know in the UK, we had a guest on last season that was for adaptive tourism. And so Access Able UK, it's so many facilities, outdoor facilities and hiking as well. And they'll really, through that app, they'll even be able to checkpoint and show you what types of accessibility are available. They have surveyors that go out, all different types of disabilities. So you really get, from just finding that one app, they'll then open your doors to seeing, follow them on Instagram, then see who these sort of companies or organizations are following. And then that kind of can bring you like a rabbit hole of other individuals or brands that would know, as well, different equipment that you could even rent or they would donate to you for using.
Totally.
We
have a similar program in Canada, app. Actually, it's a good friend of mine founded. She's been so helpful, because she was really the first like disabled friend I had. And it was while I was getting sick. When I was founding my company, we founded our companies through the same program. And just seeing how she interacted with the world and her app really like led me to start thinking about accessibility before I even needed it myself. So then when I did become a wheelchair user, I was already thinking about accessibility and it made it so much easier. But she also, we have a Canadian version of what you were talking about, and it's called Access Now. Okay. And they actually partnered with I think the government and the Trans Canada Trail, which is a trail that goes across Canada, and had people with different disabilities go out and map accessible trails. So they'll have that coming out soon, hopefully. And you know, trails in the city, trails like between cities, actually reviewed by people in wheelchairs. I think it will include photos and like different grades. And if they run into obstacles, we'll have recorded where they had to turn around, like things like that. So there is a lot of great tools available. And the cool thing is a lot of them crowdsource. So by you getting out and enjoying nature, and if you put your data in, you can help others go out and experience nature too. So that's pretty cool.
I love that. And what about, I know a big thing, like I've mentioned for you with your work, is using social media. And so I'll always encourage people in different spaces to find like the hashtags that work best. So do you have hashtags you like to use or you like to click when it comes to sort of your science sustainability side of the work you do, and then also for the outdoorsman side of work that you do?
Yeah, so definitely on like the outdoor sort of part of it, I love the hashtag outdoors for all or hashtag nature for all. As well as, what's one, redefine outdoorsy is a good one, because that one really focuses on not just people with disabilities getting outdoors, but people of all sorts of marginalized groups who have been sort of traditionally excluded from the outdoor space. So that's a really cool one, to see people like you getting outside. And so another one along that is the hashtag unlikely hikers, and it's also a page. And so that one's really good, like shares all sorts of different people just doing what they love and enjoying the outdoors. So those are the ones I like on that side. And then one really good hashtag and also page in the environmental space I'd recommend is hashtag intersectional environmentalist or intersectional environmentalism. Because it's really good, you know, like we've talked, it's not just climate change, like climate and disability have huge intersections. So do climate and, you know, racism, climate and sexism, climate and just about everything. And we need to look at those in an intersecting scope to really get the full picture. And so I think that account and those hashtags are really good at showcasing that and getting you to think about things a bit differently.
Yeah, I love that. And even from the science side and the environmentalist side too, I know we mentioned one good way to kind of put a toe into that is looking at documentaries or books or podcasts. So do you, what we say, not on demand service streaming is great because once you go and watch one, they start to curate a list and it can give you a beneficial rabbit hole to fall in. So do you have any documentaries or books or podcasts that have, that you would say these are a couple I really have enjoyed that others would too?
Yeah, so I mean, any documentaries, I love anything about Jane Goodall. And there's also one, I think it's called like Ocean Hero or something. Oh, I forget what it's called. But I love watching documentaries about female environmentalists who really like paved the way. I mean, you look at Jane Goodall and, you know, she was told she couldn't do this because she was a woman and, you know, she can't go to Africa as a young woman and be a scientist. That's not allowed. That doesn't happen. And so, you know, I think a lot of the things she overcame as a female in science are similar in a way and parallel to some of the obstacles faced by disabled people wanting to get into science and into environmental science. So I love any about her, but really just any of like the Nat Geo. Like I just love learning and watching like new environments and new worlds. I find that so fascinating. In terms of books, I'd have two I really recommend. One is Braiding Sweetgrass, and that's by Robin Wall Kimmerer. I don't know how to say her last name, but Braiding Sweetgrass, it really ties in sort of indigenous knowledge and indigenous understanding of the land, and it's great. And then also anything by Peter Wolden. He does The Secret Life of Animals, The Hidden Life of Trees, and those are really just great. They're a little more sciencey, but in a very sort of easy to digest way. Just learning how everything is so interconnected and everything has an important role. So I really love those ones.
Nat Geo, I swear, their videographers and filmographers are just fan-freaking-tastic.
Right?
I can't. It's phenomenal to look at. Even my last thing is we end every podcast always asking our guests about a best piece of advice. So I really wanted to kind of hone in, I know you have through your work in science and outdoorsman adventuring, but what is your piece of advice that you would give to other young adults who are chronically ill or disabled that really want to step into their own type of innovation?
Yeah, I mean, I would say don't wait. Just get started. I mean, the worst thing that's ever going to happen is you fail or somebody tells you no. But in both of those situations, it's a learning experience and it's a growth opportunity. And so it can be scary to do something new, especially when you don't see yourself already represented in that industry or in that space. But just because there's not someone like you there already, that doesn't mean you're not needed there. It probably means you're needed in that space even more. And yeah, don't be afraid to get started because you're afraid of failing, because failing is a natural part of life and it's something that we learn from. It's a growth opportunity. It teaches us things. So don't let that fear kind of stop you.
I love that. We always, as we say, the best step is the first step. Even if it's not the correct one, it's always the best one nonetheless. I love that. Kelcie, I had so much fun. I felt like I wasn't in a science class, which I know all of our listeners who are getting their feet wet in the science or outdoors community will love as well. So I had an absolute blast to having you on the show, and I'm excited for other people to enjoy this episode and also to get to connect with you more. So, and what you have coming up as well. So tell all of our listeners and viewers where they can find you on social media or the work that you are doing.
Yes, so you can find me on social media, on Instagram and YouTube as The Chronic Explorer. On Instagram, it's The Chronic_Explorer. And then also soon you'll be able to find the nonprofit I'm working on called Wild Ability. And our aim is to make the environmental and climate spaces more inclusive and representative of people with disabilities, especially disabled youth. And a big part of what we're going to be doing is connecting environmental youth organizations with the adaptive equipment and resources they need to make their programs accessible and to make sure that disabled youth are able to get outside, participate in these sort of capacity building programs, and just fall in love with the environment, have those experiences that everybody else gets to have.
Guys, I am so excited about that. You know, as a philanthropist, I'm always going to love when other people join the community. I'm excited. You know, 2022, that I'm going to make sure that we can get to support and collaborate in ways that we can, because that would be so phenomenal. And like I said, all of Kelcie's links will be listed below, so you can keep up with her. And then also as her nonprofit then releases more, you'll be able to see that getting announced on her social media. Too. And as always, you can find InvisiYouth on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter at InvisiYouth, and on our YouTube channel and on all audio podcast platforms. You can subscribe, thumbs up, 5 stars, write a review. We always joke, we lovely reviews are the most appreciated. And it always is super wonderful to have new people subscribing to our platform. So thank you guys again. Thank you, Kelcie, for being our final guest of 2021. And thank you everyone for listening and watching. And I will see you all again in season 4, which is very soon. Bye, everybody.
Bye.